Sullivan, who's the CEO of Xenith, has an incredible background. I have known Ryan for a handful of years now. Also a Detroiter coming in from Indian Village, Detroit. I'm in Lafayette Park, so we're somewhat close.
Exactly.
And so welcome. Thank you for your time today. We really appreciate it.
Yeah, great. Great to be here. Thanks for having me, and nice to meet everyone here virtually.
we'll take as virtual as this is as close as we can get right now. So we'll take it. So I kind of tipped the hat already, but I always like to start with where did you study and what did you study?
Well, as you mentioned, I am a proud Michigan State alum. I'm actually third generation Spartan. So throw that out there, a little trivia. My grandfather, my mom and dad, my brother, my wife. So we have a lot of green and white in our family. So I studied there in the business school, and I mastered in with a finance degree, and I did a specialization, kind of like a minor, in actuarial science. That was just something I could do to get some credit for all the math classes that I took. And I was not going to go on and do a second, double major in math. So that was my background. I was in the honors college there, which I really enjoyed, because it gave me a lot of freedom and latitude to take smaller courses and more, like instead of taking the large, you know, big lecture hall humanities class, I was able to take, you know, a small class of ancient Greek philosophy or whatever it might be. So it just was a program that gave you a lot more latitude in the different coursework that you could study. And yeah, that's my quick bio for Michigan State.
So after graduation, did you get your master's directly after you graduated, or did you have some internships or job opportunities in between?
No, I actually did not get my master's.
Sorry.
Yeah, no, that's okay. But because I was in the honors college, you could take graduate courses as an undergrad. So I took 5 MBA classes as an undergrad, which was like most of the finance curriculum as part of the MBA. So I haven't pursued an MBA, you know, since then. And I did have some internship experiences in college. My first summer, I was pretty excited. I was a bank teller at Comerica Bank. It was the first time I made $10 an hour. So I remember that pretty clearly. That was fun. Then my second 2 summers, I interned at General Motors. And the first summer in the purchasing group. And then the second summer, I was in something that they called risk management, which was really insurance, like corporate insurance work. And that was fun for me because that was in downtown Detroit at the Renaissance Center. I'm a huge Detroiter, and I always, you know, I wanted to be downtown. So that was the biggest win for me of that whole experience, was just being downtown in the summer. The Riverwalk was there. The Winter Garden had just been built. All those things. So I have a fond memories of that summer.
So according to LinkedIn, you really went the finance route, or I would say finance. That's not my area of expertise at all. So you can correct me, accounting, finance. Sure. But essentially, it looked like you went to New York.
Yes. Yep. So right after graduation, I moved to New York, and I was really fortunate. You know, sometimes in life, like you're just right place, right time, right? In terms of where you are. So in 2006, I graduated in 2006, which was kind of a boom time on Wall Street. So there was a lot of seats for analysts, right? Because there's only so many opportunities each year within the investment banking community on Wall Street. And that was a kind of a boom year. So people like me coming from schools like Michigan State, which are traditionally considered non-core for those types of roles, I had a shot, right? So went to work at Bank of America as a financial analyst, you know, so all the things that you read about or kind of glorified about, you know, the long hours and whatever. I was never really kind of into that sort of part of it. But it was a great experience. You know, I learned a ton just personally in my life, you know, having grown up in Michigan, going to Michigan State, being able to live in New York City. I ultimately lived there for about 4.5 years, meeting people from all over the country, from all over the world. You know, really, it was a very rich experience in my life, both personally and professionally. And I'm really thankful that I had those years in New York. After I left B of A, I went to a private equity firm called Vestar Capital. And it was a middle market fund. One of the really cool things that I did there and I learned most from that experience was it was not, yes, I was doing a lot of financial work, of course, but one of the people at the firm that I worked really closely with during that time was a guy named Roger Holstein. And he had previously been the CEO of WebMD. So he was what at the firm we called like an operating partner, right? He was not a finance guy, right? Or a finance person coming from that background. He had, was a person that had been a CEO of a public company, incredibly brilliant thinker, an entrepreneur. So through that experience, I really, I was like, hey, this is my guy. You know, I want to work with him more. So I worked on a lot of projects with him. He was very difficult to work for. He could be kind of an asshole at times, if I'm being honest. It was always with, it was always in pursuit of something better, of doing a great job. So I really learned a lot from that experience. And that's kind of what ultimately, you know, made me want to lead a company one day and not be, not kind of pigeonhole myself within the finance track ultimately. So that was a really important experience for me with that second job that I had in New York.
So what brought you back to Detroit? And was it after that stint at Vestar?
Yeah. So as I said, I've always, I grew up in Metro Detroit, but always wanted to be in Detroit. I don't really know why. My family was from here originally and those kinds of things. And at the time I was having, I had some personal things that led me to want to be back in Detroit. I always knew that was my long-term dream. Like I didn't want to be in New York the whole time. And just this crazy series of events, some good. So we found out that we were expecting our oldest son, whom you know, Kerry. He's now almost 10 years old. He'll be 10 years old in October, which is crazy. So actually, it's funny you mentioned that because we right around this time, 10 years ago, is when I moved back.
Wow.
I didn't really even, it didn't dawn on me. This is like
and
10
PS
years.
For everyone. He has since had three more kids. So he has four kids.
With four kids.
And as a mom of two, I'm like, oh my gosh, that's an incredible feat in itself.
Yeah. So yeah, actually, this is like the 10-year anniversary when we moved home. That's kind of crazy. I didn't even think about that. So we were having a kid, and also my mother had, who had been battling cancer for a couple of years at that point. She had some setbacks, and I was like, you know what? You know, I've always said I wanted to be in Detroit. That's my dream. I'd actually accepted an offer to stay for a third year at the firm that I was at, which I went back on that offer, which I felt guilty about at the time because they only gave out, you know, two offers that year. But the firm was very gracious and, understood my circumstance and, they were very supportive of me coming back. So it was really, I was driven by personal reasons. You know, it was my long-term dream to be here, but there was a catalyst on the personal side of life. So I think for those in the audience here, you know, I remember being in your shoes, not all that long ago. And sometimes, you know, life throws you curveballs, and this was certainly one for me, that changed the course of my life and in a very positive way. But it was unexpected, right? It wasn't something that was like part of the plan at the time. So I just started, you know, I kind of jumped out of the plane without a parachute, right? I didn't have a job here. This was, I guess at the time it was early 2010 when I made the decision to come back. And then ultimately we moved in the summer. And so Kerry, you remember what it was like in Detroit in 2010. It was a ghost town. It was, you know, the depths of the recession. It was tough. It was a tough environment. But I had always stayed connected here, even when I was in New York, because I knew, actually going back to the time when I was an intern. So this is a very relevant story. So it's just allowing me a bit of a diversion here, but I just started calling up people that I had stayed in touch with in Detroit and saying like, hey, look, I'm coming to Detroit. I'm looking for the best job I can find. Like at that point, my priority was personal, not professional. So I was just looking for anything that, you know, could put food on the table and a roof over my head. to get back here and start my family, you know? And the gentleman who ultimately, you know, hired me was a guy that I had met as an intern when I was at GM. And that man was named Matt Cullen. So Matt had been at 30 years at GM, and ultimately left GM to go work with Dan Gilbert, where he was Dan's partner on a number of initiatives, including a number of casino developments, Detroit real estate. He was most recently the CEO of Bedrock Real Estate and some other things. So Matt was a guy that I met when I was an intern at GM, and I read a newspaper article about him. And at the time I was, whatever, 20 years old, I don't know, 21. And the newspaper article was, hey, here's this guy, Matt Cullen, he's at GM. He has a family and kids, and he does all the stuff with the riverfront. And I was like, oh my gosh, like this is kind of like what I want to be like. I want to be a father. I want to be a business person. I want to, you know, give back to the community. So I looked him up on the GM, whatever they called it, like the internal Facebook, or it wasn't called Facebook at the time, but whatever, the people finder. Yeah. And I looked him up, and I was like, I just emailed him. And I said, I actually kept the email. I have it somewhere. And I just said, hey, Matt, like, I read about you in the newspaper. I really would love to meet you, basically, is what it said. And he said, yeah, let's get together. So that was after my, what year would that have been? Sophomore year in college. Stayed in touch when I came back my junior year. And then when I went to New York, we always stayed in touch. I would go visit him, like when I came back on Christmas break, that kind of thing. So then fast forward to, you know, I was well into my career and I was looking to come back. Matt was one of the first people that I called, and I never called him with any expectation of working for him. Ultimately, that's what ended up happening, but it was just to try to, like, hey, Matt, what do you know about, like, what opportunities are out there? And ultimately, you know, he had just joined Dan's organization, and he was like, you know, we could use a guy like you on the team. And that's how I joined the Gilbert organization. So that was summer of 2010. I started working in Livonia, right? We were still in Livonia at the time, which is hard to believe. I was part of that first wave of people that moved downtown. I think it was October of 2010, maybe, that we came down. I started out working with Dan's private equity group, Rockbridge Growth Capital, and then also splitting time with Rock Ventures, which ultimately led to this Rock Gaming thing, where it was like drinking from a fire hose. We were, right when I joined, Dan had won the right to build some casinos in Ohio. So I was working hand in hand with Matt through that whole process. We had a partnership with Caesars. We raised a bunch of money to develop and design the casinos. We got those up and running. We bought Greektown. We did this online gaming investment. We did a casino in Baltimore, and all that was like in the scope of, I don't know, 3 years. I mean, it was a crazy, crazy pace. And then over time, like the scope of work that we were doing was expanding, started to spend some time on some of Dan's real estate projects in Detroit. And then, you know, in Dan's world, there's always like something going on. So you'd get pulled into these different directions and different projects, whether it was maybe something on the venture capital side or some other things. So it was a really dynamic experience in that chapter of my life. I'm really thankful that, you know, it far exceeded my wildest dreams when I was just looking for a place to land. I ended up getting this, you know, amazing dream opportunity, and, you know, really made the most of it, honestly. Like it worked super hard. Had, you know, a number of kids during that period, that time frame, and now live here in Detroit, as we were chatting earlier, Kerry, as well. So a lot of things happened in that short period of time.
And you're technically still with the family of companies, as Dan Gilbert calls it. So now you're with Xenith. Can you tell us a little bit about who Xenith is, what you do, what your areas of specialty are?
Yeah. Absolutely. So yeah, definitely. Xenith is still, you know, part of the Dan Gilbert family of companies, as you mentioned. Dan is our majority owner. So that was kind of how I made the bridge from what I was doing before to being over at Xenith. If you think back to what I said a moment ago, when I was at Vestar wanting that opportunity to run a business, ultimately I was able to kind of be an intrapreneur, if you will, within Dan's world, and had the opportunity to lead Xenith, where I've been now 4.5 years, give or take.
Wow.
So at Xenith, we make gear for the football athlete, and we are best known for our helmets. That's why I kind of grabbed my prop at the start of the call. So I keep this one proudly on my shelf. I think there's only three of these that exist. One, Dan Gilbert has. The second one, Dean Gupta at the Michigan State Business School has, and me have these. So you can see here, it's a clear helmet. So you can see that our technology, that's really our kind of our secret sauce. What we are best known for is that protective technology on the inside of the helmet. So that's why we kind of do this paint on one side, clear on the other. So you can see the inside. And when I started at Xenith, we were, we like only had helmets, and we had some shoulder pads, but we were really a commodity business, if you will. Yes, we had some special technology, but you know, there was a lot of opportunity to grow the brand, grow the product offering, and that kind of thing. So over the past 4.5 years, and there's certainly been a lot of ups and downs along the way, which I'm happy to talk about. But we really decided that, you know, we changed the philosophy of the company. And we said, look, we want to design gear that elevates the athlete's pursuit in training, playing, and living. Because if we're just focused on helmets or quote unquote protective technology, we're kind of missing a whole range of opportunities that we could apply our expertise in design, engineering, product manufacturing and marketing and branding to a lot of other categories and really focus on that football athlete. So that's what we've done. We've launched, 30 plus products in the last 18 months. You know, we went from having, when I joined, there was one person in the product development team. Today we have, I think, about 15 or 16 folks, really world-class designers, engineers, multiple PhDs on staff. We've expanded to, we've launched new helmets. We've launched non-tackle headgear. We've launched new shoulder pads. And then we've launched into other categories like apparel. So I'm wearing one of our t-shirts right here. And so what we say, you know, we design for the football athlete from head to ankle. So we've really expanded the product offering. We serve all athletes from youth to NFL. And again, we're best known for our helmets. So one thing that was really exciting for us a couple of weeks ago is we won a grant from the NFL as part of their NFL helmet challenge. And we were one of, I believe it was four groups to receive grant funding to help support our future helmet product development. All of our helmets, our existing helmets, achieve the highest rankings. You know, there's a couple of third-party tests that are out there, Virginia Tech, the NFL. So that's really what we're known for, is that commitment to quality, that commitment to having high standards for our helmet product, and designing, you know, the best helmet for the athlete that performs great on the field as well as in the lab. And that's, there's a real distinction there, because you can make a great helmet in the lab, but it could be super heavy, uncomfortable, way too big, all these other things that don't really translate to the field. So it's finding that balance. I mean, ultimately at the end of the day, the helmet is a piece of performance equipment in the same way that your cleats are, or your shoes are, or your shirt, right? So it's, but there's just a lot more that goes into it from a design and engineering perspective. So that's who we are at Xenith. Really proud to be Detroit based. Our company's headquarters are here. We have our manufacturing here. So right now we're all working virtually, as we were chatting earlier, Kerry. But our manufacturing facility has been opened since May 11th. So I'm there at least one day a week to support that team. Really proud of how our team has just kind of embraced all the changes that have come along with COVID. We had one COVID case our second week back to work, and that was it, no more. And that person, they obviously didn't contract it in our facility. But with all the procedures and protocols and the way that our team has lived up to those has been really awesome, especially when you're reading in the newspaper about these different manufacturing facilities that are having dozens or even hundreds of cases. In one case I read about, I'm like, that just shocks the conscience that someone would keep running a facility in that kind of environment. But so that's a quick rundown of Xenith and who we are and what we've done in the last few years.
So I'm going to get to some of the questions. And guys, just as a reminder, if there are any questions that you want to ask of Ryan, just let me know, shoot it in the chat, and I'll get to you. But some of the questions that were submitted on the front end, So you obviously you're talking about protective gear, and obviously the safety is first and foremost. So one of our guests is a former CAST technician, football player, right. And he said he's had the privilege of wearing the Xenith gear. So right. He wanted to know, or I'm assuming he wanted to know, if you plan on continuing to stress the importance of youth's health and safety during sports activities, is there a way you could become more involved in his community? I don't, his or her community. If you're on and you want to elaborate on this, we'd love to hear from you. But nonetheless, you know, just tackling that question and your involvement in the importance of youth's health and, you know, what you're doing within the community.
Yeah, great question. Really happy to hear that we have a CAST technician in the house that wore Xenith. That's awesome. I actually have a CAST tech helmet downstairs in my kitchen randomly that Coach Wilcher left with me, and I need to get it back to him. And I did go to CAST's practice, I think it was last Tuesday night, maybe. Anyway, so really proud of the work that we've done here in Detroit. I mean, that was something that when I joined the team at Xenith in early 2016, you know, it was a big deal. Like, hey, we need to win in our own backyard. Like at the time we had no product anywhere in Detroit, none of the high schools, none of the youth teams, not the Lions, nobody. So it's like, look, we need to own our own backyard. We need to work with the teams that are in our community. We need to support this community. We need to invest in this community. So over the last 3 years, that first season, each Detroit public school, or now the DPSCD, had got 12 Xenith helmets. And then over the past few years, they now have over, I believe it's 850 helmets total in all of the DPSCD programs. And that means that almost every DPSCD athlete is wearing a Xenith helmet. They have a few other helmets on each team, but by and large, DPSCD is almost 100% Xenith. And that's something that I'm just personally tremendously proud of working with the local community. And we figured out a pricing model or a business model that we could do, as you can hear my daughter who's going down for her nap.
Is that my house or your house?
Yeah, no, it's my house, sorry. And we did something similar with Detroit PAL, where, and that was a key of, I learned the first year that I was here, I was like, hey, I want to like, kind of seed some product in the market and that kind of thing. But then the second year comes around and everyone's like, hey, we want more, you know, free product and that. And it's like, well, I can't do that forever, right? It has to be sustainable. So we've worked out what we call community-based pricing model, where all the Detroit-based teams, youth and high school, really get the lowest price on our product in the country. And it's been a win-win for everybody involved. But for us, it goes much more beyond just having product on the field. That's where it started. But over time, you know, we've really developed great relationships off the field as well. So how can we support and work with athletes in this community beyond, you know, wearing our equipment on Friday nights? So we've done some work with CAS, with King, with some of the other high schools. We've had athletes and coaches come in for different leadership discussions or kind of like a career day at Xenith. We've done some tours of our facility. Ray Lewis was in town one time and we were able to invite about 20 athletes from DPSCD to attend that. We've done some work with the Boys and Girls Club. We have supported some local artists and as part of the month of design, kind of try to broaden that exposure of athletes and art and football. We've done some really cool things kind of in that space. I'm probably forgetting a couple of things because we've done a lot with College for Creative Studies, and Wayne State as well. And we've done a lot of, different like design work or, case studies where we involve athletes from CAS or King or other places like that, as part of that. So our kind of commitment to the Detroit community, both youth and high school, is very strong. And we've done a lot over the years. And it's been very much mutually beneficial. Like it helps us out as a company. And it's also a way for us to give back and provide different experiences for those athletes. Again, in addition to wearing the product.
Love that. So you talked about expanding into other products. Have you thought, one of the questions asked, have you thought about expanding into other sports? In particular, lacrosse is their question, but in general, do you guys have your eye on other sports as well?
Yeah, it's a great question. Hockey and lacrosse are typically the questions, you know, that I get asked the most in terms of other sports, sometimes cycling or snow sports kind of thing. We've definitely explored it at different points in time. And are most of the students on here business students or majors or interested in business?
I don't know what your area of study is, but we got a thumbs up here. So they're all...
Yeah, so it comes down to the business case, quite honestly. So we have we got mechanical engineering. Okay, great. Biomedical engineering, awesome. We got a lot of engineering involved in the work that we do. So yes, we have looked at other sports. There's definitely applications of what we do that could apply to other sports. And when we've explored it, it's like you have to build a business case, right? So there would be capital, a lot of capital required to, for example, get into lacrosse. And, you know, there's tooling. It's not enough to just have like, hey, yeah, we have great technology in our football helmet. Could we put that into lacrosse? In theory, yes. But then all the rest of that investment to expand, build distribution, build your brand, build all those things in lacrosse, it's just something that as we've continued to grow and expand in football, we kind of made the strategic decision that we were going to go deeper in one vertical, if you will, being the football vertical, and gain scale there before we expand into other places. So longer term, we definitely think that there are opportunities in other sports, but you know, very near term, we're exclusively focused on football for the time being.
So this is an interesting question. Do you hire MDs, DOs, or PhDs to assist you in the development of your helmets?
Not MDs, but definitely PhDs. So as I mentioned, we have two PhDs on staff, and one of the, again, life works in funny ways. One of the most talented additions that we've made to the team during my tenure is our head of product, a gentleman named Grant Goulet. He was previously a professor at the University of Michigan and then went on to work at Adidas. And we recruited him from Adidas to join us at Xenith. So he moved from Portland to Detroit to join the Xenith team and lead our product team. And he's really helped to grow and recruit and hire for our own internal team at Xenith, which is tremendously talented. But in addition to that, we all have also established a scientific advisory board. And that was really important to us to make sure that we have outside voices that we can run things by, that we can partner with on different research, that we can show our research and development and get their perspective before we ultimately take something to market. And that scientific advisory board has a number of people from different and diverse backgrounds, whether it be PhD, MD, pediatrics, and some other things. So we have a really incredible group of people that we're able to access when needed. That are independent, and this is a very, I want to emphasize, this is a group of independent people that are all professors and researchers or professionals in other fields. So this is not like a pay to play kind of thing. Yes, there's some, kind of nominal compensation to make it worth their time. But we're not, this is true independent voice and perspective on what we're doing. So it's that blend. You know, yes, we have some folks internally, but we also have a scientific advisory board, and we seek to partner with amazing groups from around the world. So our latest helmet, the Xenith Shadow XR, I don't have sample of the material. I don't have it here. It's on my keychain. For the mechanical engineers on the call here, check out Rheon, R-H-E-O-N. We've done some webinars with them. Really incredible material science out of the UK. And then we've also done a lot of work with BASF and others. So it's that blend of building your own internal team and supplementing that with world-class talent and resources outside as well.
So I I want to be conscious of everyone's time, but you and I, before everyone joined on, really alluded to this idea of COVID is hitting everyone, right? So one of the questions is what are the biggest challenges you have had to overcome? And I would like to gear that specifically to what are you dealing with right now with regards to COVID and your business?
Well, the biggest question is, are people going to play football this year? I mean, that is the number one question, and it's there's no mistaking it. I mean, it's a very challenging time for us because a lot of people aren't playing. And if there's still, in some cases, people know that they're not playing. In other cases, people are uncertain as to whether they are going to play. And because of that uncertainty, they're not buying any gear. They're waiting until they have certainty. So as a result of that, you know, we had been having a record year up until about March 11th. And we were doing really well. And since that time, it's been very challenging. So that's the biggest question mark. And really, when you look back, you go back to like early June. And at that time, there was a lot of sentiment and optimism towards having a season this year. It was in the data that we were seeing. It was in all the headlines. It was in all the conversations that we were having with our, you know, folks that we're close with in the industry. There was a lot of optimism towards fall football. And really in the last, you know, 2 weeks, maybe 3 weeks, that optimism has, you know, in large part dwindled away. I mean, there's still a glimmer of hope in some places, but it's very challenging. So that's been a challenge. But I think if you were to go back to the middle of March when COVID first happened, at that time, we didn't know if there was going to be a season. At that time, we thought for sure that there wouldn't be. Our factory was shut down. We were mandated to be shut down by the state of Michigan. So our factory was shut down for 7 weeks. And it doesn't take, you don't have to be an MBA student. I see we have some MBA students in the classroom here. If you're not shipping product, you're not generating revenue or cash. So there's been a lot of financial challenges throughout this time that we've had to manage. And it's been, there's been a lot of ups and downs. Unfortunately, we had to downsize our team. And you know, for those on the phone, like this, I'm living through this. Like I've never had to do this before, right? I mean, this is pretty, there's a lot of challenges here. And it's been tough. I mean, there's no like sugarcoating it whatsoever. But we've also taken it as an opportunity of like, we're not just going to kind of lay down and sit back and get beat up through all this. The mantra has been, we have to focus on what we can control. So we can't control whether people are going to be playing football. We have no ability to influence that. But what we can control on is finding creative ways to connect with our customers, finding creative ways to get our product to our customers, finding creative ways for our customers to pay for our product and access it and make it cheaper, easier, developing digital tools, developing more branded content. So we've really pivoted and shifted our business in the last 100 or now I guess 120 days or so to maximize our opportunity for whatever business opportunity we're going to have in 2020. Our objective was to maximize that and take action on what we can control to best position ourselves competitively in the marketplace. And we've seen a lot of that stuff have traction and drive success. For example, our e-commerce platform has been tremendous. We've been very strong on Amazon as well. We've gotten some great traction with a team e-commerce platform, which was something that we didn't have pre-COVID. So we've gotten creative, we've gotten scrappy, and we're fighting like hell to maximize the opportunity. I mean, so that's the approach that we've taken. It's three things. It was a pyramid, okay? At the bottom is health and safety. Health and safety is number one. We're not going back to work in the factory unless we can have a healthy and safe work environment and maintain that. And we've done that. So I'm really proud of that. Number two is defense. We had to pull back in some areas. We had to, you know, conserve resources because of the uncertainty on the top line right now. We had to do a lot of things defensively. But then number three was going on offense. So We have to find the opportunities to gain an edge. We have to find the opportunities to grow in the market. And that's what we've done. So that's kind of in the prism. We broke it down real simple. Like, I want to say that was the end of March. That was a framework that we shared with the whole team. And we've really stuck to that since that time frame, and just try to be, you have to be consistent. You know, it's in these uncertain times and in all the ups and downs, just try to drive people to consistency and a solid framework to make the best decisions for our team and our business.
Well, I not only do I appreciate your time, but I appreciate your honesty. I know this is a tough time, and I knowing you, I know that that's really tough for you, especially downsizing your team. And that these are real and tough decisions that our leaders are needing to make. So we wish you all the best. We are so grateful for the time and insight you gave us today. Please, everyone, give some shout outs and thanks in the chat to Ryan.